What a build-up that we have on this show. Welcome back, everybody. This is the Atheist Experience. I'm your host this week, Ashley Perrien, and my co-host, Jeff D.
Hi, Ashley.
Thank you very much for coming on. We are live today. It is April 10th, and we're being sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. We have weekly meetings every Sunday at Crescent City Beignets on the, it's on 6th Street, a couple blocks west of Lamar. That starts at 11:30 and goes until about 1 or 1:30 thereabouts. It's very open, very friendly. Any atheist-friendly people, you're more than welcome to come down and meet and chat and have donuts and such. You do not have to be a member of the organization or anything specific like that. We do ask that it be atheist-friendly people only, though. Again, that's every Sunday at 11:30 Crescent City Beignets. Save the third Sunday of the month, we have our lecture series at the Austin History Center on 9th and Guadalupe. Now, unfortunately, I did say that I would try and have the information here for next week's lecture, but I don't.
Didn't bring that either.
You don't have it either. If you go to...
I do.
You do?
I do.
Tell us.
I
will.
You got it there.
Okay, this is on April 17th. Our lecture series will be Dees Eckstein, who will talk about current challenges to church-state separation. Dees is a Texas Director of People for the American Way, an advocacy organization devoted to mainstream values and constitutional liberties. So that will be next week at the Austin History Center, 9th and Guadalupe at 12:30. And that goes on until about 2 o'clock, I believe. Okay, so that's our usually Sunday meetings. We also have every Monday night Godless Gamers at the house of Russell Glasser, and every Thursday Atheist Happy Hour at Antonio's Tex-Mex on the southeast corner of, southbound feeder of I-35, just south of 183. That starts at 7:30. If you go to our website, atheist-community.org, and go to the calendar link, there's a link to everything that we have there, including the internet audio show, which we haven't heard about that in a little while. What is going on with that?
We're still doing it. Okay. We had a show yesterday. We do a live episode every other Saturday from 2 to 3:30 Central Time. If you want to listen to the show live, you need to set your browser to
atheistnetwork.com,
and there's a link you click on to listen to the show live. Also, if you don't have a chance to listen live, you can go to the ACA website, click on the radio link, and we have 5 or 6 episodes there that you can listen to on demand.
Okay.
It's an hour and a half show.
Those are MP3 streams, I believe.
That's right.
Okay. All right, so you had one yesterday, so the next one will be 2 weeks, minus a day.
Yeah.
So, all right. Okay, that is it for our regular announcements, I believe. A couple quick things to ACA board members and other members who may be watching. May 1st is quickly approaching, and that is our elections for new board members in the ACA. We're hoping to get a lot of new people in there. So, again, if you're an ACA member and are thinking about running, it would be good of you to try and get in touch with some board members now to know the responsibilities and find out whether that's something you actually want to do. So, again, that's elections coming up May 1st. And also, we sent out a mailer to all members recently. We're going to have some changes in the bylaws and the Constitution and stuff. We're going to be voting on that. So it will be a very important meeting. So definitely try and make it, if at all possible. Also, another quick note, off topic, but very relevant nonetheless. April is, Child Abuse Prevention Month. It's something that we've covered a couple times in the show in the past. So I know a few people who are dealing with that right now and dealing with CASA and other organizations around town. It's something important to watch out for, and if you see anything that's going on that could be questionable, phone number to call would be 1-800-252-5400. So, a very worthy organization, very, very good thing to be knowledgeable about. So, that is it for our regular announcements.
I have another couple of ACA-related announcements,
Sure, hit them.
The ACA members will be conducting a blood drive next Saturday. That's the 16th. at 10 a.m. at the Central Texas Regional Blood and Tissue Center. That's on at 45th and North Lamar. Contact Don Rhodes if you have any questions about that. Once again, that's April 16, next Saturday at 10 a.m. at the Central Texas Regional Blood and Tissue Center at 45th and North Lamar. Also, on May 5th, the ACA is going to be conducting a protest of the Austin edition of the National Day of Prayer.
Yep, that one.
Oh, that's the whole thing? Yeah. This is Thursday, May 5th from noon to 1 p.m. at the south side of the Texas State Capitol Building. The National Day of Prayer is a blatant and obvious violation of the separation of church and state, and we need everyone who can possibly attend, I guess we're talking to our members here, to be there to help express our opposition to the government's making any official proclamation in support of religious favoritism. If you have any questions, you can contact activism@atheist-community.org.
Yes, and you definitely do not need to be a member of our group to come down to this. Numbers are important.
We're not allowed to ask you to do stuff on the show, so we're not asking you.
Yes. So if that's something you would like to do, wonderful. So.
Yeah, we're going to do it. We're cool.
All right. Again, this is a live show. It is April 10th, and we'll be getting callers very shortly. We can actually go ahead and put up the phone number now, and we'll start racking up calls while Jeff goes over a news story that we have for the week.
Yeah, this was something we covered on the audio show, and I thought it was that the stuff in here is shocking enough that it deserves to be repeated here on TV. People are often ask us why we do these TV shows, and obviously the main reason that we're here is for outreach to fellow atheists, because we know that there are a lot of people out there in our culture who don't believe in any gods, feel pressured by religionists always trying to get them to conform to their ways of thinking, and we want to be there as a place for them to come and feel welcome. A second thing that we do is try to raise awareness about threats to religious freedom. I don't have my microphone on. Could they hear me at all?
Yes.
Should I start again?
It's very bizarre, yes.
How strange.
We apologize,
better,
everyone.
Except I might be screamingly loud now. Watch as I put on my microphone. Okay, so we're also here to raise awareness about threats to religious freedom. Now, I read this story, and as I read this, I'm constantly remembering talking with Christians, often on this very show, who insist that they don't want to be a state religion.
Yes.
Right? They believe in religious
freedom.
They believe that all religions should be able to exist here. They just want to the government not to stand in the way of, they don't want the government to treat them worse than other people, which, sounds fine as far as it goes. Well, listen to this. In February, 900 of America's staunchest Christian fundamentalists gathered in Fort Lauderdale to look back on what they accomplished in last year's election and to plan what's next. As they assemble in the vast sanctuary of Coral Ridge Presbyterian, with all 50 state flags dangling from the rafters, three stadium-sized video screens flash the name of the conference, Reclaiming America for Christ. These are the evangelical activists behind the nation's most effective political machine, one that brought more than 4 million new Christian voters to the polls last November, sending George W. Bush back to the White House, and 32 new pro-lifers to Congress. But despite their unprecedented power, fundamentalists still see themselves as a persecuted minority waging a holy war against the godless forces of secularism. Meet the Dominionists, biblical literalists who believe God has called them to take over the U.S. government. As the far-right wing of the evangelical movement, Dominionists want to rewrite school books to reflect a Christian version of American history, pack the nation's courts with judges who follow Old Testament law, post the Ten Commandments in every courthouse, and make it a felony for gay men to have sex and women to have abortions. In Florida, when the courts ordered Terry Schiavo's feeding tube removed, it was the Dominionists who organized round-the-clock protests and issued a fiery call for Governor Jeb Bush to defy the law and take Schiavo into state custody. Their ultimate goal is to plant the seeds of a faith-based government that will endure far longer than Bush's presidency, all the way until Jesus comes back.
Wow.
Now, even those of you who believe that such a thing might happen, that there might there might be a Jesus who comes back, might recognize that that could be a good long time. Quote, most people hear them talk about a Christian nation and think, well, that sounds like a good moral thing, says the Reverend Mel White, who ghostwrote Jerry Falwell's autobiography before breaking with the evangelical movement. Continuing the quote, what they don't know, what even most conservative Christians who voted for Bush don't know, is that Christian nation means something entirely different to these Dominionist leaders. This movement is no more about following the example of Christ than Bush's Clean Water Act is about clean water, unquote. The godfather of the Dominionists is D. James Kennedy, a former Arthur Murray dance instructor. He launched his Florida ministry in 1959. After helping found the Moral Majority in 1979, Kennedy became a five-star general in the Christian Army. Bush sought his blessing before running for president and continues to consult top Dominionists on matters of federal policy. Quote, our job is to reclaim America for Christ, whatever the cost.
Wow.
Kennedy says, whatever the cost. That's a big blank check, folks. You mean...
anything it takes.
Anything at all. Anything at all. That's what he's saying.
So scrap religious freedom.
Well, just wait. Continuing the quote, as the vice regents of God, we are to exercise godly dominion and influence over dominion and influence. You know, I think you can stop at dominion. Dominion means you're in complete and utter control. Over our neighborhoods, our schools, our government, our literature and arts, our sports arenas, our entertainment media, our scientific endeavors, in short, over every aspect and institution of human society, unquote. Now notice how he went from reclaiming America to having dominion over every aspect and institution of human society.
Why does the word Taliban come to mind?
He does not want to just control the United States and make the United States a Christian state. He wants to control the entire world. If you're wondering why we bother doing a show like this, this is one of the reasons.
This is why.
The Reverend Richard Land, top lobbyist for the 16 million-member Southern Baptist Convention, enjoys a weekly conference call with Bush advisors, including Karl Rove. The Dominionists are also stepping up efforts to turn public schools into forums for evangelism. Now, a lot of callers we've talked to just don't see why it's right that they shouldn't be able to say they're Christian, make their Christian opinions known in public schools, and most of them, I think, have a misunderstanding about what the rules are about what you can say in schools because of a few isolated cases where people have gotten it wrong, have attempted to impose more extreme restrictions against religious speech in school than are legally justified. But as a whole, even we atheists agree it should be perfectly okay for any kid to say anything they want to any other kid, as long as it's not threatening and as long as it's not disruptive.
Yeah.
Right?
The kid wants to convince another kid.
We really don't have a problem
with
that. But the Dominionists want to turn public schools into forums for evangelism, not just places where you can say religious things, but into places where it's about turning people into Christians. In a landmark case, the Alliance Defense Fund is suing a California school district that threatened to dismiss a born-again teacher who was evangelizing fifth graders. Now that is over the line. A teacher using their state-appointed position of authority to affect the religious beliefs of the students in their charge, that is over the line. In this conference's opening ceremony, the Dominionists recite an oath they dream of hearing in every classroom.
Okay, now really, listen to this. This shows what they want. Quote, I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag, to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty for all who believe. Not life and liberty for everyone.
No.
Just for believers.
So if you're not a believer, you don't necessarily get that liberty part.
If you think that does not mean that they want a Christian state, where if you are not a Christian, you are a second-class citizen who does not have the right to life and liberty, listen to what they are saying. While the Dominionists rely on grassroots activists to fight their battles, they are backed by some of America's richest entrepreneurs. Amway founder Rich DeVos, a Kennedy ally who's the leading Republican contender for governor of Michigan, has tossed more than $5 million into the collection plate. Jean Case, wife of former AOL chief Steve Case, whose fortune was made largely on sex chat rooms, has donated $8 million. And Tom Monaghan, founder of Domino's Pizza, is a major source of cash for Focus on the Family, a mega ministry working with Kennedy to eliminate all public schools. The most vivid proof of the Christianizing of Capitol Hill comes at the final session of Reclaiming America. Representative Walt Jones, a lanky congressman from North Carolina, gave a fire and brimstone speech that would have gotten him laughed out of Washington 30 years ago. In today's climate, however, he's got a chance of passing his pet project, the Houses of Worship Free Speech Restoration Act. This would permit ministers to endorse political candidates from their pulpits, effectively converting their tax-exempt churches into partisan political campaign headquarters. Now, this is another subject that comes up often, that it is, you are not allowed, when you are a tax-exempt organization, you are not allowed to engage in partisan political activities. Right?
Yes.
Our group, the Atheist Community of Austin is a nonprofit organization. We are not allowed to engage in partisan political campaigning. We can't, and we don't. That is the trade-off, right? Your group doesn't pay taxes, but you can't use that to give you a special advantage, financial advantage, that you can hand over to politicians. This bill that he wants to pass is called the Free Speech Restoration Act. Well, churches never had their free speech taken away. They traded it away for tax-exempt status. That is the bargain. Church right now, it would be perfectly legal for a church to say, we're not going to be tax-exempt. We're going to pay taxes out of the money we collect in the collection plate.
Yep.
And then we're going to turn around and we're going to support the political candidates of our choice from the pulpit. That would be perfectly legal. That is how you get your free speech back if you're a church. There is no law against that I'm aware of. Maybe some caller can correct me if I'm way off base on here. But why aren't we hearing about churches agreeing to that? Well, that's because they're not willing to
give up that whole tax
thing. They're not willing to trade one thing for another. They want every single possible right they can conceive of.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's getting a little bit off the subject. The point is, that we get a lot of Christian callers who I think are well-meaning, who don't really want to turn this nation into a place where folks like me and Ashley could be taken out and shot for not being Christians. Yep. I don't think you guys want that, most of you. But I think you may be unaware that there really is a major behind-the-scenes fundamentalist religious movement that does want exactly that. If you take them at their word, and if you listen to what they say in direct quotes, it is clear that they want the United States to be a country of, by, and for Christians only. And that's not what America was designed to be. That's just not right.
And that's the problem that we have is, again, we get these callers every now and then saying, why can't we just have a live and let live? What's wrong with religious people out there? I completely agree with that. And I realize that 90% of Christians are like that. They just want to live and let live.
We don't want to take away the rights of any queer Christians. We're not,
exactly.
We've never
that's
advocated
not the issue.
For that, and we don't want that.
The problem is these people are the vocal minority. They're the ones who are getting out there and really pushing the agenda, and most Christians are just saying,
And collecting millions and millions and millions of dollars and using it to influence politicians to get their agenda.
Exactly. And the problem is...
So it's happening whether you are the kind of Christian that agrees with it or not.
Yeah. And if you don't agree with it, you're the ones who should be out there also speaking up against these kinds of people. They don't listen to us, typically. They're just the bad atheists out there in the corner. We can safely ignore them.
But they will listen to actual well-intentioned Christians because you are the people that pay their bills.
Exactly.
You are the people who put the tax-exempted dollars into their collection plates.
Who put the dollars and the votes. The dollars and the votes come from you. So.
Okay.
All right.
That's my bit.
We've got a couple cars on the line. We're going to go ahead and take them. Again, it is April 10th, and we are live today, so if you have any questions or comments, please go ahead and give us a call. Let's start with Jonny. You there?
Hey, how you doing?
Hi. What you got for us?
I'm pretty good. I called in a couple weeks back about the Shiners. I'm not calling to talk about them today, but this guy to the left, he's not usually on the show, is he?
Once a month. Except I forgot to show up last month.
You sound kind of anti-Christian.
I'm not anti-Christian. I mean, I wouldn't choose it for choose Christianity for myself, right? And I guess if you want to call that anti-Christian, you can call that anti-Christian. But I've got nothing against the right of other people to be Christians if they want to.
See, that's not how it's, you brought it out to seem earlier.
Oh, well, now you understand.
Yeah, we're against people who try and impose their beliefs on others, which is exactly what the article he was reading was trying to do. They're trying to turn America into a fundamentalist Christian-only nation.
Well,
that we have issue with. Just saying you're Christian and going to church and live and let live, no problems with that at all.
Aren't you trying to y'all are some pussies?
Well, he made a nice strong point there, which we're going to completely ignore because he's worthless. But again, Christians out there, if you have any questions or comments, please go ahead and give us a call. We'd hate for that kind of guy to be your representative calling in and giving his opinion on how Christians think and behave and want our country run. We assume that he's not the best spokesman. So if you think you could do better, please go ahead and give us a call. So
are we waiting for calls? I can come up with some more stuff.
Okay, if you got something, go for it.
We talked about the lecture.
Yes.
Oh, here's something our atheist viewers might be interested in. There is a film that was recently made, an independent film recently made called Heart of the Beholder.
That's right.
Based on, I don't know if it's been fictionalized, I haven't been following it that closely, but based on an actual event where a fundamentalist Christian minister and other Christians in the area came down hard on a video store for showing for renting tapes of The Last Temptation of Christ.
Okay.
All right, everybody remembers what a big deal that was, right? So this is a film version of the story of how that came about, the legal battle, and the hypocrisy of the people attacking the video store.
Okay.
You can find out information about this film at www.beholder.com.
Okay. Also, a quick note here, I did see an article talking about, I know the ACA had something in the last textbook hearings, about health and biology, the school textbooks, and they're trying to push a abstinence-only sex education in schools now. And unfortunately, being relatively successful with that, there is a study out of Brazil that came up with a conclusion based on international experiences. Today, there is no evidence whatsoever that moral recommendations such as abstinence and fidelity have any impact that might prevent infection and curb the epidemic, talking about AIDS. So while abstinence-based along with barrier prevention and birth control and all the other, you know, pertinent information out there, is perfectly valid. Abstinence definitely has a place in sex education. To say that don't have sex and that's the end of sex education is not going to do anything except fail miserably.
And this is not a prediction. This is based on
study
analysis
after study
of all the
studies
that have been done. Yeah,
exactly. Both in sex, and here's one that's based on the spread of AIDS. Telling people to not have sex doesn't stop them. It just makes them have sex unprotected and without any knowledge of what they're doing. And so it is incredibly dangerous and, again, spread of AIDS.
Right. You hear that these studies exist, and then you hear people still clamoring for abstinence-only sex education, and I'm not on camera. Thank you. You wonder, well, why in the face of all this evidence don't they take the evidence seriously?
No.
And there's the one possible reason is they don't know why they should listen to that evidence, which means they just don't understand rationalism and science. And the other possibility is they don't actually care about stopping AIDS, that they don't actually care about preventing teen pregnancies, and they don't actually care about halting the spread of sexually transmitted diseases.
Yeah.
What they care about is preventing kids from having sex, which they object to morally. And that's fine to object to that morally, but, you know, your personal moral stance on issues is one thing, but the actual consequences of teenage sexual conduct are something else again. We know that if teenagers have sex and don't understand birth control, that they will get pregnant, that they will get diseases, right? We know that. Shouldn't we actually be trying to solve the problems that we all know exist instead of considering the problems that we all know exist to be secondary to the moral indignation of a segment of our population? That just doesn't seem right.
Yeah. So again, study based in Brazil saying abstinence simply doesn't do anything to curb the spread of AIDS. Again, we are live today. It's April 10th. Got any questions or comments, please go ahead and use the phone number. We have got Mike. You there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, what you got for us?
I think it's important. I was wondering if you needed to have a name for this movement, because when you try to identify this problem to them, I try to identify it to the people I know, because most people don't care. They're so wrapped up in their lives and their television, their football, and their, you know, and their overwork,
day-to-day
life, sex, and all that kind of stuff, and they're very much don't care about this, and they should care.
Yeah.
But you don't have a name to identify with.
Dominionists. They are the
Dominionists.
Dominionists, yeah.
Okay. That's what I want to write down, because, you know, like when I talk about the thing that Alex Jones talks about, I say, well, you know, this New World Order, and you say that to people, and they just roll their eyes and cluck their tongues and snort derisively at you and dismiss you as a child, even though, you know, you could be almost 50 years old.
Yeah.
And I think it's important to have a way to identify this with people without hemming and hawing and stuttering the way I do.
Now, to my knowledge.
Let me write that down. And also, I want to say that right now, people are really ripe for the picking for these people, because, for the most part, they're stupid and easily led cattle, like that first caller you had. It was just all he ever knows is
I'm not sure that guy had any point other than getting to his dirty word.
Yeah.
So.
Well, he's just been raised at. A lot of people have been raised Christians. Some are well-meaning, some are just sheep, some are cattle. And all they're going to hear is somebody saying, they think you're saying Christian bad, and you're not saying Christian bad. You're saying nothing but Christian bad. You're saying if we have a world of nothing but Christian, that's bad.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not even going to go that far. Like I said, I wouldn't pick Christianity for myself. But I have met Christians and encountered brands of Christianity that aren't too harmful, and you know, I wouldn't consider it the worst fate that the world could undergo for it to for all human beings to believe that particular religion. I'd still think it was inaccurate.
Well, you know,
I'd still think it was inaccurate, but that's not really the issue, right? The issue is that this is not one of those brands of, you know, relatively level-headed, calm, thoughtful, types of Christianity. Yeah. This is one of those, let's, you know, meddle with everybody's personal lives. Let's let's impose rigid authoritarian rules that don't make any sense, that are derived only from ancient writings and not from, you know, actually trying to address any real problems. Yeah, that is what I'm concerned about.
Well, Chris, the essence of Christianity is pretty much the essence of all religions, is that it's like Granny and the Beverly Hillbillies, when Granny had a cure for the common cold. They went, well, what is it? It turns out it's just get plenty of rest and drink plenty of fluids. You know, you're like, oh, yeah, well, that's pretty much what it is. There's nothing, a way you can really monopolize that and sell it. You know, it's just a general awareness. And that's the essence of Christianity religions, is being kind to people. And so they can't use that to bend their agenda into people's throats. But like I was saying, I have another question. When people are, I say they're ripe for the picking for the future, it's going to be because, just the influx of Mexican culture. And Mexico, of course, is just primarily a Catholic nation.
Yeah.
As this nation becomes more and more Mexican, and it's going to be, because they reproduce like spores and the rest of us are...
Whoa. Hey. Maybe you're not aware, but the Mexican government disenfranchised the Catholic Church, I don't know the exact year, roughly a century ago. They actually took away the property owned by the Catholic Church, and they've had very strict separation of church and state in Mexico up until recently. Now, a lot of the people are Catholics, but a lot of Americans are Catholics too. I mean, in every nation you're going to find people of different
persuasions. Well, my point was, I wasn't saying anything derogatory. I was just saying it's a preponderance of Catholics.
It's certainly true that all Catholics from whatever nation are in a religion that tells them that they shouldn't be using any birth control to prevent kids.
Uh-huh. Well, my point was, I was going on to say that as it becomes more and more predominant, and then you have this Dominionist, you know, Protestant, at some point there's going to be a civil war, I'm afraid, where it's going to be, they're going to drive out ordinary people who don't get involved in religion. It's such a...
I hope that fair-minded, thoughtful Christians, when they find out about this Dominionist movement, will recognize it for what it is and take steps to, you know, yank the rug of support out from under them.
Yeah,
I was just gonna say when the Dominionists eventually have to bump heads with the Catholics, that they will either the Catholic leaders say, hey, we're on your side, or they'll say, hey, no, we're not gonna be like Northern Ireland, you know, where it's absolute distinction between the two.
Well, I hope it won't go that far.
I don't want any bad for anybody.
Yeah.
And so I think I always try to write down everything I want to get my. I think I've covered it all.
No.
Okay. Anyway, you guys, thanks a lot for your time.
Okay. Thanks a lot for calling.
Bye.
Yeah. Again, as you said, we need as many rational Christians out there fighting this as anybody else, just to say, look, we respect religious freedom in this country. We respect your right to believe or not believe, or believe, you know, differently than us.
Right. But, you know, you can't on the one hand argue that, all you want to do is get back to what the Founding Fathers really wanted.
No.
And then at the same time not realize that what the Dominionists are after is not what the Founding Fathers wanted.
Yeah.
Because the Dominionists are really looking for a Christian state. They basically say so.
Yeah. So, all right. Let's go on to a couple other callers. I believe we have got Ray. You there?
Hello.
Hi.
Not Ray, but that's okay. I'm Jessica.
Okay. I'm sorry. We got on lunch, Chris. Anyway, Jessica, how you doing?
Hey. All right. A quick question. This so-called movement, which I guess could be related to bowel if you really thought about it. Get it? Bowel movement. Never mind.
Ow.
Sorry.
Don't make us have to hang up on you, Jessica.
Okay. No, I'll keep it clean. Are they trying to make this federal or state mandate, like the gay marriages, like we'll all vote?
I've got nothing in this article that says specifically, it says anything specific about that issue.
Okay.
My guess is that they'll do it however they can.
Yeah.
I mean, it seems like this, the, the cultural war which they started has not had any real boundaries. If they think that they can get the most traction by trying to implement this on a state level, they'll do that. Or if they think that the way to do it is on a national level, they do that. If they think that they need to pack the courts, they'll do that. If they think they need to elect their own presidential candidate, they'll do that. I mean, whatever it takes.
Okay, so, I see what they're doing, but call me a little flaky, but I would think the Jews and, you know, the Jews would, and the ACLU and all that would actually have a hard time with it, especially the Jews, because, I mean, what are we going to do? Is it going to be all religion, or is it just this Jesus Christ stuff?
Well, I wouldn't limit it to any non-Christian viewpoint. I mean, certainly Jewish people would not want the United States to become a place where they'd have no rights.
Uh-huh.
Neither would Wiccans,
right.
Neither would Hindus, neither would Buddhists, neither would atheists, neither would Satanists, for that matter. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean...
Which is what the wording of their article is. They say this is a, you know, nation of freedom and liberty for Christians.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
If I can guess where you're going with this, if you're saying, well, where's the big effort to stop this? I don't think a lot of people are aware.
Okay.
And if there's going to be a big effort to stop it, it has to start at some point, and that would begin with people learning what's actually going on.
Right. And just one more comment. I mean, if it does happen, which I hope not, but if it does, then they need, our government needs to tax Jesus, point blank. They just need to go ahead and tax them, and unfortunately, you know, I don't want my kid being taught theology and science, because they're two different entities there, but anyways, I don't think it will happen. Let's just hope, and whatever we do, chant, pray, whatever, this won't happen. And y'all guys take care.
Or have TV shows, yeah. Thanks.
Yes. Thanks for all. Yeah, it's definitely one of the fringe efforts out there.
It's not that it's a fringe.
Work.
It's that it is a alliance of different religious leaders who all subscribe to this particular theological viewpoint that they're supposed to conquer the world.
Yeah.
Right. And they're going ahead and working together and having conferences. I mean, 900 people at a conference is not a tiny fringe, you know, particularly not when you have, big-name Christian leaders showing up there, and not when you have major corporations funding them.
Yeah.
So it's not, it's not a fringe in that sense. It is a conspiracy. Yeah, tinfoil hat time, I'm sorry. Sometimes there are actual conspiracies, and here's 900 people that had an annual conference where they recited a pledge that said, life and liberty for Christians, period. Yeah. You know, I mean, that's, that seems
so what about
obvious.
Everyone else? So
it's not a secret conspiracy, it's just a not very well, not very much attention has been paid to it yet.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I hope that starts soon.
Yes. So. All right, let's go on to a couple more callers. We have got Ray. You there?
Hi.
Hey.
How you doing?
Quite well.
Are you Ray? Okay.
Yes, I am actually Ray.
Hi, Ray.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, first of all, I caught like more of you all in the middle of talking about the Dominionist movement.
Yeah.
Okay. Who are some of the people that are a part of this?
Okay, let me go back to my article. D. James Kennedy, have you heard of him?
No.
He runs Coral Ridge Ministries. It's a $37 million a year church with a TV and radio audience of 3 million.
And what's the name of this ministry?
Coral Ridge Ministries. That's his church.
They were very active in the Alabama Monument. They were the ones who helped out.
That's right. What was the name of that judge?
Roy Moore.
Roy Moore. Remember the Roy Moore with his Ten Commandments monument?
Okay.
The Coral Ridge Ministries, those are the guys who came in the middle of the night and filmed the installation of this Ten Commandments monument in the Alabama courthouse and then sold the videos of them breaking the law to raise money for their church.
Okay.
And for the defense of Roy Moore when he was brought to court for it.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, about how large would you say this group is?
Well, they had 900 people at their conference. And that, you know, when you have a conference, it tends to be mostly your leaders. So that's 900 organizations, you know, roughly.
Okay. The comment that I had about that is these people that are part of this movement, which I have never heard of before, mm-hmm. they are not true representation of people who have Christ in their lives because of the fact that, and this is coming from what I believe, so mm-hmm. I'm not trying to push it on you, but I'm just speaking my piece,
yeah.
that God is love, and he only operates out of free will. So if I'm correct, I'm getting that the Dominionist movement are trying to force people to, yes. they're trying to take over and force people to believe what they believe,
well, they,
but God gives you the free choice to choose if you yeah. want to believe it or if you don't.
It's not clear from the article whether they intend to line people up against a wall and force them to sign oaths of Christianity,
mm-hmm.
or whether they intend to simply ask you if you're a Christian, and if you say no, shoot you through the head. It's not clear, and or it could be something a lot less extreme than that. But judging from their pledge, there's no room in their America for anybody who isn't a Christian. And I don't know what they plan on doing with non-Christians.
Maybe put us
in labor camps. I don't know. I'm still a strong young man. I could lift heavy objects for them.
I don't know. I really think that even this movement that's going on, whatever they're trying to drive people out and this only be a Christian nation, you know, like I'm going to just go back to the thing that I truly believe, that God is love. And he gives people free choice to do what they want to do.
Okay,
that is your choice. And then let me just add this, that they would not outcast people, because that would not be right at all. That's totally against the Bible.
We're glad to hear that.
And
we started this segment, you know, talking about this article, saying that we know there are Christians out there like you who will hear this stuff and go, no, right? That is not what you want, and you don't think that's what your religion says you should do, right? So part of what we're doing here, we're not just talking to our fellow atheists. We're talking to Christians like you.
Uh-huh.
So when you hear about the kinds of things that this movement is trying to accomplish,
mm-hmm.
you'll be aware now of the kinds of people who want that to happen.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
if you came in late, let me go quickly over the list of some of their objectives. Okay.
Okay.
They want to rewrite school books to reflect a Christian version of American history.
Mm-hmm.
And that includes stuff like, I mean, we've covered stories of textbooks introduced into schools that say slavery was actually not as bad as everyone says, and biblically okay.
Hmm.
They want to pack the nation's courts with judges who follow the Old Testament laws. That's like Roy Moore. They want to post the Ten Commandments in every courthouse. They want to make it a felony for gay men to have sex and a felony for women to have abortions and stuff like that. Okay. So when you hear Christians trying to achieve those kinds of things, you might want to just stop for a second and ask yourself whether the impulse behind that objective is actually these Dominionists.
There's a big difference between what I would generally call live and let live Christianity, which sounds like is basically where you are. You have the right to believe what you want to believe. Other people believe what they want to believe, and so on. And
I won't say
we
can
all live together.
I won't say I'm a live and let live. I do believe in free choice, but I am someone, and I will say this, I don't believe in driving people out, but I do believe that there will, now this is my opinion, and this is based on what I believe.
Okay.
I do believe that there will be a movement of people of their own free will turning their lives over to Christ because that's what they want.
Yeah.
Because they, in my opinion, which I believe is truth, I believe they will see that is the truth.
Yeah. But me, and if that's what happens,
them, no, because I don't operate like that.
Yeah, and if that's what happens, then again, that's a free choice that, You can't government sponsor that. But if someone is coming to you saying, we want to legislate based on making this a Christian nation, that's where we need people like you to stand up and say, no, thanks.
Well, trust when I say that people that try to do things by force in the name of God, they will be set down.
which is
if
what they're
the
trying to do.
It's the wrong way. It will be set down. And it may not be by man, but it will be by God.
But
trust when I say he will do what he needs to do to get what his will
needs to be done. But let's also not force God's hand in this, if that's what you're proposing.
No, I'm saying that God will sit down.
We need people like you and other Christians to actually make the votes and do some of the work to say this kind of thing doesn't get passed.
It's not going to go that far.
So, well, let's
keep
not
your eyes
just
open,
assume.
As always saying.
Yeah, keep your eyes open and
oh, my eyes
do the
will be
votes
open
and
I
work.
Will watch, but okay. I guarantee you
don't just
that
assume.
Anyone who falsely represents God will get sat down, and it doesn't have to be my man, because God will do it before any man can do it. That, I understand what you're saying.
That's
you're
where
saying
we
be
have
active.
Big issues. That's where
you're
we have
saying
big issues.
Be active and watch, and I understand what so. You're saying, and I know it's hard for you to see things the way I see it, just like in some ways.
So you're not
going to
be active.
So basically,
you
you're
think
saying
this is
that
terrible, but you're not going to lift a finger to stop it because you think God's going to take care of it.
Yeah.
No, I do believe, and there are things. If you want a job, you don't just sit at home and pray. You fill out your resume and you go out.
But that's
and
what
you
you're asking us
done.
To. That's what you're asking people to do. God will put this down.
Because that's
even
a little
if people
extreme.
Don't do
I cannot.
Anything.
I cannot see that happening. I cannot see this. I cannot see that happening.
It will happen unless people like you stop it.
And it is happening.
Yeah.
We already have the Republican Party in this nation, but a fine political party, got no objection to the existence of a Republican Party. But there's no secret of the fact that they are, that their recent success, where they control both houses of Congress and the presidency, is largely due to the influence of right-wing Christian fundamentalists, many of whom are these Dominionists. This is no secret. They are already winning. And the stuff you're hearing now and are going to be hearing in the near future about Congress wanting to change the balance of power between Congress and judges, all their attacks on what they call activist judges, that is more effort by this movement to completely take control of the United States government. That's what it is. It's happening now.
And so relying on God to stop this is not a safe thing to do.
Well, you know what? I'll just say this. I have to learn more about this movement. And
That's always
so new
exactly.
to me. And I will research it. I will even bring it to my pastor. But I really, like I said, it's so new to me. But right now, the way I feel is just, you know,
please,
how I feel.
Please don't just take our word for
it.
You do your own research. That
exactly.
is the very smartest thing you could do.
Exactly.
And thank you very much
but
for
But I
call.
Do enjoy the new information you exposed to me. So just be blessed.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot for calling. We're not saying people should just take our word and oppose, you know, the Dominionist movement offhand.
You may well discover, depending on what kind of flavor of Christian you are, you may discover if you look into this that that is exactly what you want, in which case we would think you're a horrible person, but that's your choice.
Yeah, but again, this is something that is currently going on now. Hoping that God is going to take care of this and stop it is not what we should be doing. What people should be doing is if you oppose this, say so.
Hey, and we've had callers try to tell us that we were, you know, acting as the, that God was acting through us by telling them important things in the past.
Yeah.
And we've gotten calls like that. If you want to believe that, I don't care. Sure, what the heck? You know, we think we're atheists. We don't believe in a God. But if that's what you want to believe, if that's what you need to believe in order to take us seriously, that's fine by us too.
Yeah. So.
But we would never make that claim.
We were not put here by God, as far as we can tell. All right, let's go on to other callers. Let's see. Darryn, you there?
Yes.
Okay, what's your
voice? I was just wondering if there were any other Dominionists other than D. James Kennedy. Were there any other?
Apparently
at least 900 of them went to this meeting.
Yeah, 900.
What about any of the leaders, actually?
Oh, God. I will quickly try to scan through this article and pull out more names because I only read selected sections. It was a long article. Okay.
But if you probably do a couple Google searches for D. James Kennedy and Dominionist movement, that type of thing, it would probably bring up
other Dominionists.
Have information.
Okay. Gary Cass, C-A-S-S, is the executive director of Reclaiming America. There are political figures that are associated with this movement, like Representative Catherine Harris of Florida.
I'm aware of her.
You've heard of her.
who urges them to win back America for God. Let's see. Okay. Well, I don't want to.
Well, that's cool.
There's more. I urge you to do your own
research.
Because
also,
you'll find more.
Wanted to say to Jeff, I had actually called about a month ago the Christian morality thing.
You guys
had a segment on that, and you were telling I had actually just converted to Christianity, and you were saying that was like a bad idea, and yeah, it really was.
My opinion.
Because that didn't really work out.
It
lasted about like a week.
I have to admit, I completely do not remember the phone call.
Yeah, I'm sure you have like a lot of stuff you're doing.
Okay.
But I just wanted to thank you. You guys are doing a great job, and I support your show.
Thanks.
No problem.
I'm going to burn in hell. if there is one, I'm in so much trouble.
If you hadn't figured that out yet.
Oh, well. Oh, yeah, Roy Moore, by the way, if we hadn't mentioned him, he's, of course, involved in this.
Yes, I'm sure.
I can just scan this while you go and take more calls and yell out more names as they come up.
All right. Okay, quick note also, forgot to mention earlier on, after the show, many of the cast and crew, we go down to Chili's on the southeast corner of I-35 and 183 after the show. So any atheist-friendly people, if you're watching, you want to come down and meet some of us, you are more than welcome to do so. Again, atheist-friendly, southeast corner of I-35, 183, Chili's. The show ends at 6 o'clock. We'll be there around 6:40 or so. All right, let's go on to yet more callers. We have got Anne. You there?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
What you got for us?
I have a couple of questions and a couple of comments.
Okay.
I'm curious. Thank you for this article about the Dominionists, because I had heard about it, but I hadn't heard what a name to put to it.
Okay, the details, yeah.
And where did this article appear? That was one of my questions.
Oh, you know, if I was a really good journalist, I'd be able to tell you. I think it came from some liberal rag. You know, I mean, one of the really liberal ones, not one of the ones that if they do anything that the right wingers don't like, they get called liberal. But okay. Like one of the really liberal ones.
Okay. Is there a name for the person who wrote the article?
I don't have that either.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
I can give you the
you have the title of the article or something?
The title is Christian Evangelicals Plotting to Conquer America.
Okay.
If you type those words into a search engine, maybe you'll find it.
Okay.
But, you know, it's not like there's
Christian Evangelicals Plotting to
conquer America.
Okay.
If there was anything to this, then you don't have to find this specific article. There should be more information on them out there.
Right, okay. And I also have another question. The man who is coming for People of the American Way next Saturday to talk to you, I won't be able to come to hear that, but I actually have a question for him, for you to ask him.
Oh.
I know that People for the American Way have just mounted a campaign to continue the filibuster.
Okay.
And part of that is up until recent, well, I think it takes 2/3 to vote down a filibuster.
I think 60%,
and what they're trying to do is make it a 50-50 vote. And because one of the things that has happened is that George Bush has put up, again, several judges' candidates that were rejected last time.
Yeah.
And this is one of the ways they're trying to push them through, if they can get a 50-50 vote instead of a 2/3 vote.
Yeah.
Right.
And so I'm curious about, because you talked earlier about how one of the ways the Dominionists would work is to load the courts, and this is what's Trump. This is one of the things that I'd be interested in finding out more about.
Mm-hmm. What they're doing in that direction?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
So if this man could be a guest on your show next Sunday, or bringing more information about what he said to your show next Sunday.
Okay.
We will
try
to do that.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
And enjoy your show. Gives me a lot of pleasure on Sunday afternoons.
Thank
you much.
Bye.
Here are some more names pulled out of this article. Senate Majority Leader Bill Frist is courting the support of the Dominionists for his presidential bid. Reverend Gary Beeler, a Baptist minister from Tennessee, is named. Small-town activist Kevin McCoy is named. Also, House Majority Whip Tom DeLay is the winner of DJ Kennedy's Distinguished Christian Statesman Award. So he's been given DeLay has been given an award by this by the leader of this movement. And I mentioned before, Representative Walter Jones, a congressman from North Carolina.
Okay. All right.
That's all the names I could find in that particular article.
Okay. All right, let's go on to a couple more callers. We have got Steve, you there?
Yeah, I'm here. It sounds like a question we want to ask every politician is, are you a Dominionist? But that's not
wow, that would be a good question.
But there's this mini-series coming on next week on network TV called Revelations.
Is this the...
I don't know anything about it, but it looks like, you know, a schlock miniseries made for TV.
About Revelations is all true and it all comes true? Yeah.
I don't know exactly. Wow. It's got lots of special effects.
Unless there are two networks doing it, I've seen a trailer for one, and yeah, it's pretty creepy. Though I'll say, for me personally as an atheist, one of the best contributions that Christianity has made to our culture is as a source of cool imagery for like horror films and weird psychological or supernatural thrillers. I really like that kind of stuff.
And
if that's their angle on it,
this bothers me. But there's a write up in the show world from the Statesman today about it. And one of the things is talking about different people. There's different characters, and it says one worships science, one worships God, and one worships Satan. They're the human circuits of those gods battling it out to see who's right.
Wow,
that sounds really
interesting.
But I bet you anything, no network is going to air a miniseries where it turns out that the science guy is right and the religion person is wrong.
Yeah.
How much you
or that the Satanist is right. They're for sure not going to do that.
How much you want to bet the science guy either gets exploded or...
turned into a Christian.
And,
Yeah. That's generally the way it goes.
Killed by his own
I don't know. If people, you know, it's weird. If that's what's popular in entertainment and people really accept it, then there may be a pathway for the Dominionists to take over the country. Yeah.
Well, people like Tim LaHaye with the Left Behind series, they've made movies of those, and they pretty much all bombed.
Well,
so
this one might do the same, but
like I said, I can imagine a more general appeal. It's probably still going to be pro-Christian, right? Yeah, you'd expect that. But right. I can imagine a more general appeal sort of supernatural thriller based on the Book of Revelations that wouldn't bother me. I just enjoy it with my popcorn as, you know, a weird fantasy
movie. It's a good science fiction movie versus a tool to try and convert people.
But I think it takes a movie like that to have broad appeal because these like really hard-line right-wing fundamentalist left-behind movies have not had broad appeal.
The article says, bringing to television a tale that centers on biblical prophecy, Jesus Christ and the New Testament was part of the mission for the executive producer, Gavin Pallone.
Okay, so this is going to be a conversion tool.
So maybe I'm full of it.
Yeah.
Well, I don't think you're full of it. Who knows what this thing's going
to
be.
I'll wait for it to come out on DVD.
Yeah.
So, be warned.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks for the time.
Okay, thanks for calling. That will be something to watch out for, though not too hard. All right, let's go on to a couple more callers. We have got...
Before you take the next caller, and on the subject of films, I should mention there's a great cannibal priest character in Sin City right now.
Oh, okay.
If you want, you know, cannibals that eat human beings, that's there for you.
Nifty.
Those of you who aren't looking forward to the Revelations film.
Yeah, so...
Okay, go ahead.
All right, let's go on to another
caller. And that's also fantasy. Nobody's suggesting anything like that.
It's real.
Well, priests don't eat, you know, dead people.
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm saying.
Maybe some live children. But
that's what I'm saying. It's not real. It is a fantasy. It is fun beliefs, ideas.
So glad you're not getting my gag. Go on to the next call.
Okay, whatever. Anyway, we have got another caller. Let's go on to Chuck. You there?
Yeah, hi. It's Chuck. Chuck Z.
Hi, Chuck.
You don't recognize the name, you'd recognize the face.
Okay.
But on the subject of Dominionism, I can't hear you guys.
Turn your TV off.
Yeah, I'm trying to get a balance of the sound here so I can hear what y'all are saying and what I'm saying.
Now, you should be able to hear us through the phone if you just turn off the sound.
Yeah, it should be okay.
It's not very loud, and it's a cell phone. I may have to go back on the landline. Anyway, if you want more evidence of what the, about the Dominionists and what they're up to, go to www.stopactivistjudges.org and do it after the show.
Is that one word, stop activist judges, all strung together?
Yes. Yep. Yeah, type out all the words. Stopactivistjudges.org.
Okay.
They just had a conference in Washington, D.C., Thursday and Friday. And the first day was broadcast live on C-SPAN, and it was pretty scary stuff. You can possibly catch it on a repeat. You know, how you kind of never know how much C-SPAN is going to repeat something. They did repeat it a couple times this weekend.
Okay.
Some parts of it I saw three times, actually.
Wow. Okay.
All right, we'll look for that. Thanks.
Okay.
Okay, there's more about it. I could comment if you're interested.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, I've got some,
Well, you were talking earlier about what levels of government activism these people are talking about, and they were advocating actually all levels, activism on all levels. Grassroots movement is necessary. Write your representatives and congressmen and have them impeach judges, request that they impeach judges. Of course, there's still a lot of this still feeling the victims. And as far as the list of some of these folks, already mentioned Roy Moore. Apparently, Tom DeLay was supposed to be there, but they talked like he had to cancel at the last minute.
Aww.
Yeah, what a bummer. I was looking forward to seeing him. But there's a whole list. You can see the website if you go to their schedule page. Lists all their speakers, but Phyllis Schlafly was supposed to have been there, although C-SPAN didn't cover that, and I missed it.
Okay.
Jerry Falwell. How's
he doing?
Michael Ferris, Elvita King, Rabbi Daniel Lappin, Rod Luce. Anyway, the list goes on. And
Rabbi.
Richard, you need to check it out.
Wow. Okay.
I would tend to work against the other woman's theory that the that Jewish people would automatically object to this if there's a rabbi involved.
Yeah.
But, you know, there are different strains of Judaism as well as Christianity, and, you know, they take all kinds of different angles on all kinds of different things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, thanks very much for that information.
Yep.
You bet.
Thanks
for I will definitely go and check out that website.
All right. Again, phone number is on your screen. If you had any questions or comments, please go ahead and give us a call. All right, yeah, we are having that National Day of Prayer. Again, any ACA members who are watching, the elections for new ACA board members are less than a month away, May 1st. So be looking for your packet in the mail of information about that, and keep an eye out for the notices that are coming out.
Do you want to talk a moment for about the National Day of Prayer?
Sure.
We could do that. I have been at a previous ACA protest of one of these horrible things.
Yes.
And when I say horrible things, I don't mean that prayer is happening. We're totally cool if you people that believe that there's some point to praying want to pray. We don't care. Yeah. That's fine. The problem is when you use the government and say the government is going to specifically endorse a particular religious activity. Right?
Yes.
That's the problem.
It is the government who is sponsoring this and saying we should all pray for this, that, and the other.
Because that's like the government. That is exactly as wrong. Now, putting this in a, from a perspective that Christians listening to the show may understand, that is exactly as wrong as if they had a national day of, ritual sex for Satan. The thing is, the government should not take a stand in favor of any particular specific religious activity, right? And the common response that we get all the time from Christians trying to tell us this is okay is, oh, no, there's not really any separation of church and state. All the Constitution says is that there's not supposed to be one single monolithic state religion. Well, what are you telling us then? Are you telling us that if the government officially endorsed, say, the Baptists and the Catholics, that therefore it's not one single monolithic state religion and then it's okay? And and your Buddhists and your Muslims and your atheists and your Jews and your Episcopalians and all other people of all other religious viewpoints, the government could go ahead and snub them and never say anything good about them, as long as the government has at least two religions that it's promoting. Because, you know, prayer is a general thing that Christians and a number of other religions believe has, you know, there's some point to it. But when the government signs up for that, folks like us atheists that think prayer is a big waste of time, we're left out in the cold with our government telling everybody else, those atheists are wrong. This prayer really is important. You know, and just as if there was an official national day of ritual sex for Satan, they'd be telling all you Christians, the government would be, oh, no, no, it's not just Satanism we're promoting here, the government, right? We're also promoting the tantric Hindus, who also believe in ritual sex. Right? Oh, that's not one single monolithic state religion. That's two different religions, so we're not breaking the rules. Okay. No. The government should never even go there in the first place. Should never go there.
They definitely have issues with the abstinence-only programs in schools on that day, too, but hey.
Yeah. Pray all you want, that's fine.
Exactly.
But please, do not take hold of the reins of our government to make a big point about how your praying activity is so much better and more important than every other religious viewpoint. Because it's wrong. It's a violation of the Constitution, and it just cannot be.
Yeah.
So we're going to be out there protesting.
Thursday, May 5th, from noon to 1 p.m. on the south side of the state capitol building.
Yep, up on the steps.
So be good if you could join us.
We wish we didn't have to, but, you know.
Exactly.
We have to stand up for our rights also.
Just on this show, we're out there to try and make sure that Christianity does not take over. If it was not a threat, much of the need for this show would not be there. So, all right, let's go on to a couple other callers. We have got Ted, you there?
Hey, guys.
Hi.
I really enjoy your show, and you fellas really do a tremendous service
to
the community. You really, really do. In fact, if I can say this, guys, both of you are more Christ-like than most Christians.
Not too sure.
I can't grow a beard, though. I've tried growing the beard. It just doesn't work on me.
Well,
sandals, though, I'm right there.
What I wanted to talk to you all about, have you guys, I'm sure you have noticed this even more so than I have, but have you noticed these guys in authority, all of them, the senators, the whole group of them, have you noticed their tremendous lack of self-judgment? I mean, just no self-judgment at all. No attempt to place themselves in their fellow man's shoes.
I'm not going to paint absolutely every political figure with that broad brush, but I'm willing to paint like 90% of them with that brush, if that's close enough for you.
Well, and I was a member of an evangelical church about 14 years ago.
Okay.
And I finally got out of it, you know, when they started to tell me how to dress, you know, little subtle things.
How to dress, really?
Oh, yeah.
How did they want you to dress?
It's extremely controlled in a lot of these fringe organizations. And one of the things also is the fact that, you know, in the Christian faith, I think, if I can, guys, just for a minute here, you're supposed to judge yourself to come to Christ, and then you judge yourself even more afterwards.
Okay.
You're not supposed to judge yourself less,
okay,
and you're not supposed to stop with self-judgment just because you believe that Jesus Christ, if you believe that, rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, because every devil in the universe believes that.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
We know what you're saying.
Yeah.
You know, you need to be taking that point of view to your fellow Christians.
Oh, I do, guys.
Okay.
I do.
All right. Because, you know, we don't really care.
I hear you. But, you know, just everywhere I go, you know, I just say, man, self-judgment. Come on, fellas. It's real simple. Don't you want, I tell the guys I'm with, don't you want for men to treat you like you want to treat your fellow man? How hard is that?
Yeah.
But anyway, guys, I'm not going to keep you any longer. I just want to say that both of you, I think, are more Christ-like. And if Jesus were around today, I think he'd be pleased with both of you.
He'd approve.
In a way. You know what I mean?
We'd give him a run for his money.
Well, you're good men. I really mean that.
Thank you.
You're real good-hearted men. And
all right.
You do a great service. thanks, fellas.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot for calling.
Bye.
Geez, can we use Jesus as a sponsor for our show?
I don't know.
Even Jesus would
that,
like us
that probably earth. Wouldn't make a whole lot of sense to people.
All right, let's go on to a couple more callers. Again, we've got about 20 minutes left in the show, so if you have any questions or comments, phone numbers on your screen, go ahead and use it. We have got Matt. You there?
Hey, what's up?
Hey, Matt.
Yeah, I was going to talk about Dominionism.
Uh-huh.
Sounds more like demonism to me. And I really think that the people that are the people that supposedly represent religion and in the government, like you're talking about, these people that are in the government, they want to put judges in, they want to put Congress people and stuff. These people are actually satanic. These people, they'll tell you they believe in God. Everything's backwards these days. Everything that comes out of a politician's mouth, when George Bush says the culture of life, he means the culture of death. All right, and this whole Dominionism thing is going to make people hate religion even more, but more and more people will become religious after, you know, you got like 9/11 and stuff, and you see all this religious imagery like you guys had when that guy came on and was showing the Twin Towers with like Jesus over it. He had pictures.
Yeah.
You remember, Ashley.
Yeah.
So,
unfortunately, as much as I can understand the idea that if all of a sudden government is in the business of trying to jam religion down your throat, people will revolt against that and say, no, it's a personal choice and da 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 da. As much as I like that idea, I don't know if that's actually what happens. I see a lot of people just kind of rolling over for it and saying, okay.
Well, yeah, you got like the faith-based initiatives and stuff, all the faith-based initiatives. You could have a Church of Satan and sign up for that stuff. You could be Anton LaVey saying, I'm gonna go ahead and sign up with the government and get tax exemption. Just because a religion is accepted by the government.
Chances are he's not going to get it, though.
Yeah, that's one of the problems with that whole faith-based initiative thing, is they want to have, the people in the government that want to have that also want to exclude religions from it that they disapprove of, such as Satanism. And, you know, I'm sorry to have to tell everybody such a shocking thing, but in the United States, simply being a Satanist is not against the law. I mean, I'm not one. I think it's every bit as silly as Christianity.
Yeah, but sacrifice
but
is.
If you do crimes, then you should be subject to the law like everyone else. Part of the problem here, I think, is I remember years and years and years ago when there was this landmark case where Rastafarians were given a special exemption to go ahead and have marijuana for their religious ceremonies because they were religious. And over the years, I've heard more of these special exemptions for religion. I think that is where we started going down the wrong route.
So when they start putting microchips in people and all the Christians are like, no, that's the mark of the beast, are we going to have to herd up all the Christians and put them in camps? You're talking about putting non-believers in camps before.
Oh,
Christians putting non-believers in camps. What about if they put Christians in? Because, I mean, you guys, I've watched you guys for a long time. You almost think that religious people are mentally ill, right?
I think religion is really, 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 really silly.
It is.
Okay. Now, but to my knowledge, there is no atheist movement equivalent to this Dominionist movement. There is no movement by atheists to take over the government. We are not a movement to take over the government and make it illegal to be a Christian.
We
all the time are telling people, if you want to be a Christian, you go right ahead. We have no problem with that.
Yeah.
And it's entirely up to you.
Again,
the problem we have.
Church and state, though, right?
The what?
You're all about separation of church and
state.
Sure.
Yeah. What does that have to do with anything?
No, that's cool with me.
That's keeping the government out of religion. That's not a common thing we hear is that separation of church and state means federally enforced atheism. We hear that a lot. But you know what? We'll tell you. We're atheists, right? There is way more to being an atheist than just not openly performing any religious ceremonies, right? Just having the government not officially perform any religious ceremonies doesn't make it atheistic. The government would be officially atheistic if it put up signs in courtrooms saying, there is no God.
All right.
Right?
Well, let's see.
Or
some
if they
more
celebrated Robert Ingersoll's birthday.
Let's
you know,
see
stuff like
stories.
That. That would be government-funded atheism, and we're not in favor of that either.
Well, that's what I'm saying, is the people in the government, to me, are satanic. I believe they believe in a God, but I don't believe it's Jesus or anything.
Okay.
Well, that's what they're claiming.
You can believe that. I don't really know or particularly care. I care what they do, not what they believe.
Yeah, we take them basically at their word.
Yeah, you'll know them by their fruits, right?
So,
only some of them are fruits.
Exactly.
It was a joke.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Okay.
Anything else, caller?
Thanks a lot.
All right. Thanks for calling. Yeah, it's crazy.
That was a tasteless joke. I'm sorry.
Huh? It's some crazy people out there, and like I say, it's scary. Once you start having these government allowances for religion,
yeah,
no matter how small it is, it starts getting down that slippery slope where it's dangerous. Christian Scientists did something on them a long time ago. They're basically relatively small sect of Christians who disagree with medical science and say that you should pray to cure disease and stuff like that. They typically do not take any kind of medical attention at all. And so if you are a practicer of this religion and anything you do, if you are a Christian healer and you go to people's homes and you charge money and you pray over their, you know, dying grandmother or something like that, that money is tax exempt. They have little exclusions in there to say that if you're a Christian Scientist and you get money, and any monies you make from that are tax exempt.
Wow, I hadn't heard of that one.
Little things like that.
I had not heard of that. Because that's a religious practice.
Yes.
Well,
so it's essentially government sponsoring of this, because while they're not paying you...
You know, the tax exemption thing is a separate issue. I mean, again, the ACA is tax exempt, too.
Yeah.
And I don't have... And we're about a point of view on religion.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with that, necessarily. If I did, I'd be a hypocrite. So I don't have a problem myself, necessarily, with tax exemption. I do have a problem with getting the tax exemption and not... agreeing to the rules that come along with having that tax exemption, like being nonpartisan.
Yeah.
Right? That is the problem I have there. This does dovetail into another story, though, if you don't mind me doing a quick separate thing. We did cover this on our audio show also. You may have heard of some cases cropping up recently of pharmacists who refuse to dispense certain kinds of medication. Birth control related things in particular, though also in the state where, the state where there's
Florida,
illegal assisted suicide, there's drugs involved in that, there where people have expressed a reluctance to dispense them anyway. So there's this movement now, and they actually have an organization called the, where is it? If I find it, I'll tell you. There's actually an organization now trying to stand up for the right of pharmacists to be conscientious objectors.
Yeah.
Now, the pharmacists are generally licensed by the state. They're also employed by, you know, drugstore chains and so on. And the states and the drugstore chains are scrambling to try to find a compromise to enable these people to remain pharmacists while not personally having to dispense these medicines.
Yeah.
And this organization that's forming now for pharmacists that don't want to dispense birth control is responding by saying, well, you know, we don't even agree with that because we're not going to step aside and let something we see as sinful happen. So they not only want to not themselves have to hand you the medicine,
they want to, and have, in
several cases, they take your prescription and refuse to pass it on to another pharmacy.
Wow.
Because they don't want to be involved even at that level.
Yeah.
But you know, what strikes me about this is this whole idea of conscientious objection. The only place I've ever heard the term conscientious objection before is the military. Well, what's different about being drafted into the military and choosing to become a pharmacist?
Yeah.
Well, it's that choice thing. I can see a purpose for recognizing such a thing as conscientious objection when it's the government
ordering you
to be in the military, and you saying, I have these moral strictures against things I won't do, and them saying, okay, fine, we'll work that out, right? But why do you need that for pharmacy? if you're going to be a pharmacist, you should be aware that there may be drugs that are legal, medications that are legal, that you have a moral objection to. And to insert yourself into that process and then say, because I happen to be, oh, lucky me, right? I've had some woman's birth control pills, you know, the responsibility for those passed through my hands. Now I can interfere with somebody else's medical choice, and we'll call it my conscientious objection. No, I think that's complete and utter nonsense. If you go into that line of work, you should not be interfering with other people's right to get medications that are legal. If you don't want them legal, there are ways that you can work with the process to try to make those things illegal. And to my knowledge, there is a lot of effort out there right now to try to make these things, make birth control illegal again. You know, there's groups you can join. What you should not be doing is pretending that somehow you have a special right to interfere with somebody else's medical decisions. I just think that's horrible.
Yeah, and I've heard a couple people on the radio make the slippery slope argument with me is saying, what if we start applying this to other jobs? Can you be a taxi driver and have issues with driving people to any other churches or religious buildings?
That is an excellent point.
You know, I will not drive you to the synagogue, ma'am. I am a Christian.
Yeah.
Find another taxi.
Right. Just please. Don't go into lines of work where your personal religious views are going to... You know, I'm sure it happens by accident sometimes, right? I'm not saying any time it ever comes up that somebody made a horribly stupid decision. But if it's likely to come up, please don't go into that profession. Yeah. And but I just think that the whole idea that there should be conscientious objection to tasks related to a career you chose doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah. So. All right, I've got about 10 minutes left on the show. Again, any questions or comments, phone number is on the air. We'll get to a couple more callers. Let's go on right now to Andrew. You there?
Hello. Hey.
Hey.
Hey, I just want to say, first of all, great show. I love it. You know, I watch it as much as I can.
Thank you.
And my question arises out of something I heard a couple weekends ago. I was surfing the net one time, and someone posted a, it's apparently some AM talk radio show that plays in California. I forgot, I should remember what it was called, like John and Ken or something. Okay. But on it, they had a famous pastor, priest, that, the show is about the Terry Schiavo case, and the priest was going on about how, you know, this respect the sanctity of life and blah, 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 and save Terry Schiavo. And he never actually directly answered any of the questions that the talk show host asked him. And eventually what happened is that the talk show host just got incredibly angry and basically started, like, yelling at him and just got him off the air. And it kind of just made my jaw drop because I can't recall any other time in, like, the past number of years that I've actually heard anybody yell at a pastor or some kind of religious figure on television. And what I'm wondering is just why there's been so little resistance to this Christianification of America, you know?
Well,
because
I'm sure
again,
there are
people
that can realize how dangerous it is. And, like, look at the whole evolution, stem cell research, this medical, Christian science stuff, Christian medicine stuff you're just talking about, you know?
Yeah.
It's a real and direct threat to America and the prosperity and just humanity as a whole. And yet everyone just sits back and idly watches it happen, and nobody actually seems to fight it. Yeah. There are very few people in general who do. And I'm just wondering, why that is. Why does no one take a stand against it?
Do you want to take this first?
That's partly what we're doing. We're out here to give our opinions and our views. And
I've yelled at ministers on this show.
We're taking
glad
up the
to
fight.
Do it.
but again, I mean, that's an important part of this show is to educate people and let them know what's going on so that if you want to fight this stuff, you know that it's out there, the Dominionist. A lot of people simply don't know about it. And when they hear that, you know, there are these people who want to try and make the government safe for Christians, then they'll know that.
Well, the government shouldn't be safe for Christians. That's not the problem.
Exactly,
exclusively for Christians.
Exactly,
that's
they're painting it that Christians are being persecuted and such.
Right, right.
And so they're using this imagery and this idea to get people out there and vote for them, and not pointing out that, oh yes, and we want to make this a Christian nation, Christian only nation.
But are there really so few atheists out there that this actually, that this strategy actually works. Like, well, like what are some numbers of the percentage of this population, of the population of America that are atheist versus Christian or other religions?
According to the most recent reputable poll that I'm aware of, it was 14 and some fraction of a percent of people polled said that they were atheist, agnostic, humanist,
or none of the above type
or,
of
thing. General non-religious. Now, possibly of that 14 and some odd percent, some of those people believe in a god but are not
practicing.
But are not practicing, yeah. And I don't know where that line is. But up to 14% of the population, according to that poll, are people who do not go around basing their decisions on an assumption that there's an invisible man in the sky that cares what you do.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think that's necessarily the reason for the lack of questioning that we see. Because one thing I've noticed on doing this TV show is that Christians love to question. I mean, we get Christian callers all the time, and they love to have discussions. It's not that they agree with us, right? But they like to question as much as anybody else, right? They're just as willing to go, that Christian over there, I'm not sure I agree with their interpretation of the, you know, the religious commands. But they don't talk about it, and I think that's largely because it's considered rude to do that in church, which is about the only time when they get to have these discussions. So I think there would be a natural tendency to ask the hard questions of religious leaders. So it's not lack of interest, you know, just because of religious allegiance. I think that we just have a cultural assumption that religion deserves to be treated with kid gloves. That as soon as something is called religious, it's special and it's extra rude to ask them serious questions and hold them to answers. And I hope that changes, but that is the way it is right now. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, it does. I guess I can't think of anything else to say. You've answered my question.
So, you know, next time you encounter some religious person, ask them some hard questions.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's how it would start with people.
To logic or reason.
The what?
They'll just backtrack to the Bible. They'll say, you know, like, you never respond to logic or reason. You know, they'll say, well, it's God's will, it's God's plan. You can't question it. It's how it is. It's how it's supposed to be.
Yeah. Well, there are responses to that, too. You know, to folks like us who actually debate Christians on a rather regular basis, there's responses to their responses, and it, you know, it goes on, leapfrogging down the trail of logic until you come to, well, I just believe just 'cause. And, you know, you can't get past that, but once you've backed a Christian up to, well, I just believe just 'cause, at least you've divested them of the mistaken notion that there's any actual good reason to believe what they believe.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I like to go for the jugular when I have these debates. The amount you want to debate with them, if at all, is up to you.
Yeah, I just found it's pretty pointless to attempt to. But thanks for answering my call. Good luck with the show. Keep the good work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you much.
It's not entirely pointless. Every once I,
exactly.
I don't know if I want to crow about this, but who was the guy you called earlier who said that he had just become a Christian in 2 months he has decided that the advice I gave him was correct and that Christianity was not for him.
Yeah.
Wasn't pointless. The debate I had with him was not pointless.
And it's also important to note sometimes that the person you're debating with, they may not get anywhere with this. But depending on the forum, people who are watching, while not necessarily converting to your ideas or anything like that, they may at least see that there is an opposite viewpoint which is relevant and has good points to it.
Yeah.
And so they will then take action on that.
Yeah. They may refrain from making their most ludicrous arguments later.
Exactly.
Right? In fact, I think all human beings ought to welcome
good
polite
debate.
Questioning of their beliefs, because it's only by having our beliefs questioned that we're able to figure out if we're wrong and correct them. Even if Christians are mostly right, if they make some arguments that are wrong.
And that's what we're here for.